It is my great pleasure this morning to welcome our own Energizer Bunny, Reverend Sonia Davidson, who I am sure will bring you a message to stir you up and enlighten you and fill you up with all the energy you need today. Help me welcome her.
I asked for that.
Okay. No problem.
There's a story behind that, but it's not for this morning, right? Welcome, everyone, to the Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living. That includes those on the World Wide Web. It's a wonderful, balmy day, and we are so happy that we live in a country where the sun shines almost all the time, and when rain falls, just when we need it. It's a wonderful day.
We'll just
keep out of the way.
Right? Thank you. You want to put it here?
There's no omen there. Okay, now we can do it again. Okay. Am I projecting to the back? Okay, and I don't have to lean forward, right? You can hear me?
Yes.
Great. My talk this morning is, What If? I was inspired to focus on the whole notion of happiness. Although we speak about it so much in this temple, and it's now the topic of so many courses, lectures, and there's even the labeling of countries. There is the happiness index. It started some years ago when somebody had the bright idea to decide that they wanted to find out which was the happiest country. And it turned out that it was a great surprise to many because it happened to be Bhutan, which was one of the countries which did not have all of the things which are conventionally thought of as required for happiness. So since then, you may have noticed that the definition of a happy country has changed, and there is now a long list of social and economic resources that are required for happiness. And so I thought that it would be a good idea for us to reflect. You know, at that time, Jamaica, I think, came pretty high up. I think we came second. But since now, it was what? It wasn't second. It was high. No, we are nowhere to be seen on the happiness index. But we know that we are happy people, right? Mm-hmm. Now, my question is, what if you had all the money you could spend and give away in a lifetime? What if you could guarantee that you would never be ill for even a day? What if you had the influence to open any door in any country you chose? What if you had fame which preceded you wherever you went? What if huge crowds of adoring fans expressed their admiration for you wherever you went? What if you were to deservedly receive the highest national honor? What if? There are many more what ifs. Would you be happy? I leave that as a moot question for you to answer. I have answered it for myself. somebody who is biologically programmed to be happy, as we all are. But for some reason, it seems to stick to me regardless. Doesn't mean that I don't have quite a catalog of things that could be thought of as reason not to be happy. But for some reason, my attention span, fortunately, is quite limited. There's a Bishop Butler who once said, the attempt to be happy is one of the chief sources of unhappiness. It's a bit of a paradox, but the pursuit of happiness, as we go along, I hope that will become clear. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi of Transcendental Meditation fame says, and I paraphrase him, that often in our early stages of spiritual growth, in the pursuit of happiness, we mistakenly turn our search outward towards the things which give us instant gratification. When we do so, we may fail to heed the call from within, the still small voice, because the din of the call of the senses is so strong. He calls that the mistake of the intellect. When we decide that any person, thing, experience, circumstance, or situation is essential for our happiness, then we are depending on that which changes rather than the call from within, that which changeth not. Such happiness is pleasure, but is fleeting at best, and at its worst may be associated with worry, lest we lose what we have or fail to gain what we seek. A recent acquaintance told me of a situation where a well-off, successful friend of his was bemoaning the fact that something he was striving to attain was eluding him. The friend was becoming progressively more unhappy as he worried about what he wanted and had not gotten. This friend said in a caring voice to his friend, go home, count all the things you already have. The friend did just that, and to their mutual surprise, the friend felt better immediately. The science of mind textbook tells us if one will sit in quiet contemplation of the good as an inner experience, he, she will experience the good he contemplates. It is so easy to lose sight of the many blessings we already have that we fail to appreciate how fortunate we are. I put it to you that there are more things that we have than the things that we are seeking after. If we are bent upon losing focus on what we have, we feel that this lack causes us to depreciate what we already have instead of appreciating it. And this can begin a cycle of loss and regret. Because when we think don't have, we get more don't have. And then fear begins to set in because we fear that we may get more don't have. Grief and shame are some of the things that are associated with us wanting things that make us stand out. And grief and shame are the children of regret. If we should have done this, we should have by now been further along. We should have been married and have 3 children. We should have had a house. We should have. That is a little hint of shame. So grief and shame are the children of regret. They are conceived by keeping our thoughts on the past, fantasizing about what could have or should not have happened. Worry, on the other hand, is a child of fear, conceived by projecting thoughts of uncertainty about the future. Regret and worry are parents of unhappiness. We offer them a legal separation by celebrating the good we have and believing and anticipating more good. As we go through life, we should prepare ourselves to seize the moments as they come, by training ourselves to be masters of our reactions. The fact that it may not be easy is no excuse. Intention followed by practiced attention is the way. If we intend to be happy, keep it simple. Just intend to be happy. The universe knows how to orchestrate for us to have the experiences and the things that we associate with pleasure and that we interpret as happiness. So we practice keeping our attention on our intention to be happy. Every second of life is filled with opportunities to make choices about how we perceive and interpret our experiences. If we would benefit most from these opportunities, it is important that we assess how prepared we are to master our own mental household. Is my spontaneous reaction one which evokes pain or pleasure? If it is pain, are we learning from it? Are we growing through it? If pleasure, is it at another person's expense? Or are they partners in the pleasure that I'm experiencing? Am I in control of my reactions? Can I direct my attention at will? Does it go where my emotions take it? Or can I direct it consciously wherever I choose? If we choose to use an analogy of cricket, of which I'm a mere observer sometimes, life bowls, you bat, you bowl, life bats. Something crops up unforeseen by you. The success of your response depends on how practiced you are in the art of choice. How are you going to choose your response? And that is your batting. Block the ball when it comes. Swing it if you feel confident, right? Sometimes they get you out, but it don't matter. Life always goes on. We must choose how we will interpret any experience that comes along. It takes practice because you can't wait until you get the experience and then you explode. You have to practice intending to be happy no matter what. And having done that, you will have programmed your mind, your brain will have the neural networks, and you will kick in whenever the time comes. The Science of Mind textbook again reminds us, no man can be happy who lives in continuous condemnation of people, conditions, or things. We must learn to praise and not condemn. So often the things that make us unhappy, and I know that because I spend quite a lot of time listening to people who are so unhappy, whose blood pressure has gone up because the boss treat them too bad, or the husband keep the place too untidy, or the children won't study, and instead of contemplating the good about them, because there is good. So what? Yes, he keep the place untidy, but you know, he comes home, he loves you, he does whatever. Find something good, man. Yes? And the children, look how many people would love to have children, eh? Yes? Find something good, right? I had an experience the other day. It was so pleasant, quite recently. I have the habit of, when I think patients have gotten it about what to do physically, that I throw in a little one. I don't preach, right? But not there. I throw in a little one. Now you know that it's not enough just to have a wonderful diet, just to get enough sleep, to get exercise. You know, you have to deal with the spiritual part of it. So I threw that in for a patient who had been accompanied by a friend. And a friend jumped at his immediate and said, yes, same thing I tell him, you know, right? And then he proceeded to give me a story about how important it is for you not to allow your emotions to run away with you. And there were so many lessons. I took up my pen and I said, oh my gosh, you have given me my talk, because see, I had not decided yet exactly where I would go, and you have come and given it to me. You see how God works. And we had a wonderful laugh together, and he said to his friend, you see how God works, right? And so this gentleman's name is Richard, and he's given me permission to quote him. He's a part-time bus driver. He came on duty to drive his bus a particular morning, and he had a passenger who was determined that she wanted a refund on her ticket because she had decided she didn't want to take that bus anymore. He explained that that was not allowed. The old woman, it was an old one, did not take kindly to that response and insisted that she be refunded. Richard stood his ground, explaining again and again. Then the woman began to get very loud and angry in her insistence. She now had an audience, so that made her even put up the decibels, and the body language was there. And she just kept going and going. 5 minutes later, she was still going and going. So Richard just kept. He said initially he felt a little, you know, something. I interpreted to be annoyed. But he said, I turned away from the feeling. His words, I turned away from the feeling. He said he took a quick decision to offer no resistance with the intention to turn things around. At first, he said he did nothing, and he allowed the woman to rant and rave, and the whole bus was cheering. And buses are exciting places, and you must take a bus sometimes, right? Entertainment, man, and there was the referees and all that kind of thing. Okay. 10 minutes later, still cursing, but no, Richard, stillness had caused the decibels to came down a little bit, and the tone changed. It was quieter and less harsh. Now Richard turns on some lively music and begins moving to the beat, enjoying himself, man. Then he cried out and said, come sit with me, love, enjoy yourself. Sit beside me. Aren't you my friend? I don't know you, said the old woman. May not know you. You think me look like your friend? Yeah. You think me I look friend, right? So laughter peels out of the bus, right? But he kept on and he kept on. And then gradually, her tone changed. 15 minutes later, just to abbreviate, Richard and the woman were exchanging friendly words in quiet tones. The entire bus of passengers looked on, shocked, silence, as the woman came off the bus, thanking Richard. Richard drove happily on his way. He kept that, the memory of the experience brought him great joy, because he felt even more power in himself that he had chosen to be an example of non-resistance. He may never see her again, neither may the passengers ever see her or him again, but they will never forget his example. We too must realize that we are ambassadors wherever we go. We know truth, we must practice it and be like Richard and turn away from whatever does not feel good within us. The great philosopher and psychologist William James is quoted a lot in New Thought. He lived during that period of New Thought ascendancy. He says the happiest people are those who go on believing and anticipating on better and better. Now, he's a very interesting man. He was born 1842, died 1910. He was a trained physician at Harvard University. He actually spent several years for those days. It didn't take 6 years those days. He took 6 years because he was repeatedly ill. He suffered from severe bouts of illness and depression. And he eventually overcame them to become a professor of philosophy and psychology at Harvard. Even though he started out as a medical student, qualified as a doctor, he did not practice as such. Now, amongst the greatest contributions of William Jones is that of insights into happiness, especially the idea, according to a web magazine, pursuitofhappiness.org, happiness consists of orienting oneself to higher purpose, even if that purpose cannot be rationally proved to exist. You need to find something that turns you on, that you think is bigger than you, that your life has meaning, and that you are open to allow the universe, God, to use you for a purpose that maybe you have not yet seen what it is, but you know that you are here for a purpose. So you decide, I am open. Here I am, Lord, use me. And he says people who are consciously and deliberately in that frame of mind tend to find more fulfillment, more significance, and all of the attributes and attitudes associated with that happiness. He himself had a turning point because in his darkest hours, he was tempted to give up his belief. He felt all along that he had control over his life. But the illness was so persistent and hung on that he found himself in a crisis where he was beginning to accept the fact that he had a biological problem and that he could not overcome. And so it did not match with his original belief, which was deep, and the two contending ideas struggled with each other. Until one day, you see, when you have set your intention to be something or do something, something crops up. An essay, a single essay from a French philosopher, Charles Renouvier. He saw it and it had in something which reinforced his belief in free will and put him right back on track. He began to recover after seeing this. This is why it's so important to work while it is yet day, for the night cometh when no man can work. Don't wait until you're in the middle of a crisis. Don't wait until when you're deeply ill. Work every day, every minute, with the idea that happiness is my intention, it is my choice. I am biologically programmed to be happy, so I'm gonna let it loose. And circumstances, the universe knows how to integrate, to bring things together. So he said when he grasped the idea that yes, free will is true, it's right. He says, my first act of free will is to believe in free will and to keep my mind made up. Now, you see, the mind is bombarded constantly, the conscious mind, with bits of information that had programmed in our subconscious mind. It's continuously bombarding us. And we, as it comes to our awareness, we must choose which ones we would like to entertain and which ones we want to turn away from. And so this is how we get the practice. As we go about our daily life, just be more aware of the thoughts. Sometimes, you know, we can look at our thoughts like wild horses, just running around, waiting to be tamed, right? If you ignore them, they continue to be wild. So entertain the ones that make you feel joyful and the ones you think will demonstrate positive things in your life and the ones which do not, then you turn away. Happiness requires choice. Happiness requires active risk-taking. It's only risky to those who observe, but to you who know that there's a law that supports it, it's not a risk. But you sometimes you have to step out and do certain things which your heart is telling you to do, which your intuition is prompting you to do, because it seems bold and you have never done it before, but it is in keeping with why you're here. And happiness involves as if thinking. So when you step out to do the thing, you have to begin to act as if you are already there. You can think of many examples where, yes, okay, you start a business, right? And people are saying, "Whoa, you start a business at your age, right?" And you have to know, take risks, step out, because there's that within you which knows, right? And then you have to begin to act as if you are successful in it. Step out, right, and act. No, happiness often comes after a crisis of meaning. That's what William James called his crisis, a crisis of meaning. He says, and he spoke about those people who, yeah, he says some people just are happy all the while. He calls those the firstborn. And he called the second born those who have some ups and downs in life. You know, the life looks like it's filled with crises, but they keep overcoming the crises, bouncing back higher than they were before. And he used the example of a famous Russian novelist. I think his name is Tolstoy, something like that. Eh? What is it?
Tolstoy.
Okay. Here are the singers. Okay, they know it. And he cited him as an example of how successful effort to restore himself to mental health led him to be more than his original condition. He transcended it and remained stronger, more powerful. And William James has a book, Variety of Religious Experiences. He says the process is one of redemption when one overcomes. It's not a mere reversal, especially physical health. It's not a mere reversion to natural health. And the sufferer, when then saved, is saved by what seemed to him a second birth, a deeper kind of consciousness, right? Being that he can even enjoy more. So if any of us are really going through what we would call a crisis, where things are just at us, where we have to keep reminding ourselves as truth students about the truth, and know that if you keep steadfast, doesn't matter what direction you are being pulled in, you will be pulled towards what you know to be a fact. Perfect God, perfect man, perfect expression, perfect experience. Now, some examples of people who overcame, there are so many. You could Google it and find thousands. But I'm mentioning some New Thought people. Mary Baker Eddy, founder of Christian Science, she overcame illness to become a believer of such faith that she was the leader of Christian Science Church. Myrtle Fillmore and Charles Fillmore also overcame illness, the founders of Unity. Emma Curtis Hopkins, the teacher of teachers, right? She was called that because she was the, many of her students became founders of New Thought churches. Nona and Melinda Brooks also. Remember Saul? Some people thought he was just, I think he had epileptic seizure, right? Based on my description. Saul became Paul, right? He had to overcome to become Paul, and you know what is his role in Christianity. Albert Einstein did not speak until age 4. Thomas Edison was told he was unfit for formal education. Benjamin Franklin dropped out of school at age 10 because he couldn't afford the school fees. So we of necessity must embrace our crisis opportunities. Not that we must look for any. It does mean that you have to have problems in order to overcome. But if they come, but don't stand up and cry. You ever see a cricketer stand up and bawl because they bawl too fast or it's high or a bumper? No, lick it, okay? All right, there is no shame in challenges. There is no grief that will not give way to peace. No sorrow that will not yield to joy. I heard the Muslim, a little, I don't know if you heard Muhammad Ali's tribute, oh my gosh. And I cried when there was a little, don't cry now, Muslim girl, I think, who she said at 8 years old, when stones were being thrown at her, Muhammad Ali, she didn't know him, but just hearing of his life, gave her courage to overcome. She said, I can do anything. I know that. And I'm not sure about the second part. So any of you who heard it, you can prompt me. He said, impossibility is an untruth. Is that it? I can be anything. Friends, possibility is everything. We are programmed for happiness despite our challenges, perhaps because we grow in the process of overcoming them. Be encouraged by 1 Corinthians, know ye not, chapter 3, verse 16. Know ye not that ye are temples of the living God, the temple of the living God, and the Spirit of God lives in you. The attributes of God are manifest in you and in me. Sons of mind, sex work said, pure spirit exists at the center of all form. There is no limit to its manifestation except the limitations we set. So we acknowledge the pure spirit and we permit its attributes safe passage through the wilderness of our untamed thoughts or bring it out into clear expression. Life is living. Love is loving. Light is our intellect and its wisdom. Peace is peaceful. Joy is happiness. Power is powerful. Beauty is beautiful. All these attributes are in us. Bid it come forth. Bid it come forth out of the undifferentiated pure spirit. Tom Johnson, Lessons from the Source. We are going through an internal process of a self-awareness, self-transformation, self-discovery. Our every experience brings us further along this pathway. When we realize that it is up to us to create our own destiny, that this is what we are doing, then we will accept the challenge and really take off in an excited and creative way. It is exciting to take hold and to know that we know, and know that what we know is that which has given us the power to be all that we can be. The God within knows how to meet every situation we may encounter. Overcoming is our passport. Happiness is our destination. Namaste.